Oh man.
What are we gonna be doing today?
You gonna skit today?
No, yeah, no skit today. No skit today.
What about?
No, ma'am, today. No, ma'am.
Checking the mail?
Checking the mail? No, we ain't doing no checking the mail today.
The book club!
Oh, come on, come on, come on! It's the book club! It's the book club! We know, neighbor, we know. that the Lord will be with us, that he will keep us, and that he will watch over us. Well, Patty, what you think about loving someone versus being in love? What you think about it? Jump in. What do you think?
Well, here's what I want to say about it. It's a strong thing. This is on page 8 of the first chapter.
Page 8.
I really like it okay. so much because we talked about how love is such a strong feeling. And I was thinking about also how it talks about how when you really say you love someone versus being in love with someone, when you're really in love with that person, then your focus changes, you know, off yourself and what you think about is that person all the time. And it's the same with the relationship that we have with God. You know, if we say we in love with God, then if we really do love God, like we say, then our focus would be always to have our mind stayed on him, to keep his commandments, you know, to love him with our whole heart, soul, and not to seek after him. But it's the same way with your relationship with your husband. Or your
Miss
wife.
Yvonne, that sounds real good, but I want to get right down to the nitty gritty. I want to know, neighbor, I just keep playing. Neighbor, I want to know, what's the difference between being in love with somebody and just loving them? Tell me, Nia, what do you think?
I think it's just like Mr. Yvonne said, when you in love with somebody, and the book is that a strong feeling and infatuation. And then in those subtopics, it talks about how you fall head over heels. It takes the focus off of you, but when you just love somebody, it's not that way. Like when it said, it talked about Solomon and how he turned away from God and how he no longer was in love and he just loved him.
Now, when was Solomon in love and then he just loved him? When?
When he was, it was like he had all of the wish, but he turned away. I know that he turned away when he started going to other gods and worshiping them with all his strange wives.
Okay, so Nia's telling us that we are in love with the Lord, correct me? We are in love with the Lord. If we're doing everything, listen, neighbor, it says, have you ever loved someone who didn't love you back? And I got this title because I thought about the Lord, about how much he loves us. That's where I got this title from. I thought about how he gave us everything when he gave us Jesus. And it didn't stop there. Jesus gave us everything when he gave us his life's blood. He loved us. Sometimes he does not like us, but he loves us. He gave his whole life, but yet, let me tell you, people will tell you all day long, nobody can live free from sin. Well, I just want to get this book and put it right on their front porch, neighbor. You know what I'm saying? I want to put it on their front porch and say, have you ever loved somebody that didn't love you back? What y'all got to say about that? Come on.
I thought about infatuation.
Come on, Charlotte.
Yeah. And it's like you got to compromise anything that you're holding on to. You got to just let it go and focus your whole being on God. Because when God first found you, it was like somebody you never met, like you never known this person. And they took you to a place that you never know, that you never knew. And to be somewhere, to go somewhere and not know where you're going and not know where you're going to end up at, it's something great when you find out where you're really going and how deep you got to go and how you know that God going to take care of you, how you know that you ain't got to worry about depending on nobody else to take care of you. You ain't got to worry about calling on nobody. You can just focus on God and you know that he going to take care of you because he gave you a new heart, a new man, and now you can think straight. And that's the best feeling in the world.
Yes. We're talking about being in love with the Lord. Well, let's travel through this. Travel through this book. And I'm on page number 5 today under the subtopic. And I love subtopics, y'all. Amen. Under your relationship. It says here, our lesson today is about your relationship with your maker. Yes, the one who made you. The one who came and died for you. Some people take a break. Now, I got some information, and I got it right here in the little notes on the bottom with the number. And I'll let you know that I got some of this information off the internet. Yes, neighbor, the internet is good for some things. I got some information off the internet. I read different articles from different people, some of them in professional in the field, who talked about loving someone versus being in love. I've got some information about dating. I got information on the difference between. I went to WordPress. I went to a couple of different locations. So I have all the information right here on the bottom on page number 5. And it says here that some people, they take a break from paying their tithes. Neighbor, is that you? Is that you, neighbor? Come on now. We're talking about loving someone versus being in love. Come on. They take a break from bearing that tithe. Some people take a break from forgiving. Some people take a break from long-suffering and being kind and meek, gentle, and tender. And yet those same people, they claim that they still love God. Well, one of the authors that I looked at, he said here, taking a break, he commented, means not cutting ties to each other, but just postponing the relationship temporarily so we can see what things stand at. What y'all think about that?
I think that's just loving someone, not in love with someone.
Just loving someone. You can pick them up and put them down whenever you get ready.
That's not being in love. And it makes me think about, it's something else in this book that kind of ties into what we're talking about. I love this book. It's so wonderful. Because I think everybody can benefit from when you're married, you're not married, right. You're single, yeah. You're trying to find your way with God, maybe you left God, you really want to come back to God. It's like anybody can really benefit from this book, but me being a newlywed that I am, what I really honestly learned
from God. Got married like over a year ago. Yeah. She's still. Go ahead.
Still on honeymoon. But no, on page 7, it's my favorite because it kind of like the Lord brings us, like, I'm married, but he brings you from the reality of what you're in to a point where he wants to see your relationship being married to him. And that's what I learned. It's like I was reading this, but what stuck out to me the most was about how powerful words are. And I was thinking, man, you know, if I'm loving my husband, he's supposed to love me, would I be in love with him continuously if I'm saying the wrong words out of my mouth to him? Mm-hmm. But it all ties back to God. Because what I thought about, like, man, if I'm saying hurtful things to my husband, he's saying hurtful things to me, who am I really hurting? Not only our relationship, but who am I hurting? I'm hurting God. Everything goes back to God. And that's what I thought about when it says your girlfriend, because Reverend always say that that she her husband, he said, I'm married to my husband, he's happy to be my boyfriend. Mm-hmm. But I just thought about that because that's how it's supposed to be. Yeah. All the time, when you first meet God, it's supposed to be like you never, ever, you always have that same compassion and same thing in a marriage. But if I have God as my core, then my marriage is going to be the same way. And that's what I got that from.
That's wonderful. Anybody else? What did anybody else get out of that?
It also said, mostly, most people think about, like, infatuation. So they feel like if you in love with somebody, it's mostly infatuation. But Reverend Thomas brought out in the book, how we know that couldn't be true. Because you got to think about being in love with somebody, then you'll have that compassion. You know, these are the things that you'll show all the time. It's right here. You'll have that compassion. You'll have that long-suffering. You know, those things you'll have if you're in love with the person. And I thought about when Sharon was talking, was that if we are in love with the Lord, and we say we're in love, I say that. If we say we are in love with God, and we say we're in love with our spouse or someone in our home, like our mother, our father, you know, the relationships that we have with each other, you know, our siblings, and we say that, you know, we love them, but the truth is, you got to think about that if the things that you say helpful to each other, then you got to be true to God the same way. So you can't say we are in love with them.
And that's just plain old scripture. The Bible tells us, how in the world can you love God whom you have never seen, and you can't get along with your own companion that you chose? Nigga, I'm just bringing right back to this book. Have you ever loved someone who didn't love you back? But one of the other things that I really like was your girlfriend, which was on page 7, the second paragraph. It says here, what is the difference between loving someone and being in love? It is clear that being in love is kind of a spark or a flame included in the feeling of love. It is when that flame dims that the people say they are no longer in love with their spouse or their girlfriend. Let's see how I could just put this in a spiritual sense. In the high priestly prayer, you know that's in John the 17th chapter, Jesus stated, he was talking to his father. He said, Lord, I have not lost any. All of the ones that you gave me, I still have. Why? Because they love me. Because they love me, Lord. He says also, but he never said that you couldn't leave. You have free choice. You can give your whole heart to the Lord. You can give your whole self to the Lord. Or you can just be a part-time lover. And when people do that, I just say, you know what? You're in love with a stranger. You don't even know who the Lord is. Because being in love is about taking risks and taking chances. And by that I mean, if you've been hurt in the past, how are you going to ever heal? You got to turn it all over. It's a risk that you can afford. It's a risk that you can take a chance on, giving your whole heart, your soul and your man, yes, and your body to the Lord. And that's when you know that you are really in love. Come on, jump in. What else stood out to you in this great book?
I found out how people say, you know how people say that.
I love you, I love you, yeah, I love you.
Yeah, that too. But how they say they love someone, but they not in love with them no more. And how I thought about what Sharon said about how words affect the relationship. And how easy it was, like, before you got married, and then y'all did all different types of stuff. And then the games that y'all had played to give each other. And cause y'all
did y'all hear what this teenager said? Hold up, this is my niece. What's her name again? Tell, look right there, tell her. She said y'all was playing games. What's your name? Now tell her what grade you just graduated from. And she know y'all playing games in the eighth grade. Have you ever? Hold on, finish.
They get married, they stop being in love because they stop doing what they used to do. And that
maybe they was never in love because on page number 13 it say, I love you, excuse me, I lust you.
I love you.
And just to add to what Nia was saying, also what I got out of this is to also thank you. I was thinking about all the wonderful things, just reading this. I always bring back on the topic of marriage because I'm like, you know, that's my circle now. But no, just thinking about how much work it is. How hard,
and it's work.
It's a lot of work, and I, you know, well, I was taught in this ministry before I even made a decision to say I do. I was taught it's work. I was taught it's, you know, you go on a honeymoon, but you know, life don't happen, and it happens. But what I thank the Lord the most for, just all this, just having this information, but it's all tied back to my relationship with God. Everything starts with Him. And I was thinking, we don't, in my marriage, we have disagreements. Just like in my relationship with God, I may not understand everything, but as I keep on going and traveling just in obedience to God, things always unfold. It's the good for me. It's the same thing in my marriage. As long as I keep God the center of my marriage, it's going to work out. And as long as I keep myself, continue to keep praying and keep on talking to the Lord, I'm going to always have that fire for God. It's no different. But I'm learning that God has got to be the core of everything. But I can't leave God. If I leave God, everything in my life is going to falter, especially my marriage. And I hold my marriage very dear.
That is very, very good what she's saying. Come on, try with me, neighbor. Page number 14, I'm telling you. And you know, in each and every one of my books, and now I am just published my sixth book, I tell you so much stuff about me, so much stuff about my children, so much stuff about me rearing them and how my parents reared us. And under the subtopic, it says, my son will not listen. Well, if you've been watching WJYS for any period of time, you know my son was murdered nearly 3 years ago. So I always talk about my son and my other four children in all of my books. But this one says here on page number 14, my son will not listen. And maybe you're out there. Maybe you are my spiritual son because I am your TV mama. Listen. It says that when my son was murdered, people were telling me from here to Zion that God had another plan for his life. I said, don't lie on God. Stop lying on God. The only way God was involved, it was that God was keeping me safe. Daniel probably could have died in January instead of July. My son died 3 years ago this July. And if God had not been in my life, maybe he would have died earlier. But Daniel's death was by choice because we warned him. We talked to him till we were blue in the face. That the neighborhood and the people that he was socializing with, they were bad news. And for people to say that God took him, no, God kept him on this earth as long as he could. But God can only do so much. He loved you so much, he gave his son for you, but then it's a part that you got to play. It's a part that you must play. You got to face the truth about yourself. And I go on to say here, God had another plan for him. No, he did not. God has nothing to do with death except the death of one of his saints to bring them home so they won't keep on suffering. We told Daniel to stay away from those parts, but he was so smart, just like some of you. But you got to face the truth about everything that's in your life. You got to face the truth about everything that's in your life. And some of you married couples, you need to get down to business. The problem lies within yourself and not with your companion. The problem lies within you. And you know, I teach the people here, and they can elaborate, the people that's here in our group today. You can live without a lot of things. We didn't have a lot of clothes. We didn't have a lot of necessities. But we had love. And that's something that you cannot
really mature spiritually or physically or emotionally, you cannot thrive without love. Yes, you're going to grow up. Yes, you're going to get older. Yes, you're going to get taller. Yes, you're going to get some muscle. Yes, you're going to get a receding hairline.
Amen.
But where is that love? What you all think about that? How important is that today in rearing our children, in serving the Lord?
Yeah, that is very important.
You know what I thought about? I thought about the title, What If You Turn? About Solomon. And it says, the Lord warned Solomon. He told him, Solomon, Solomon, I will establish your throne. Just follow me. Solomon, I will establish your throne. And here it is in verse 6. But if ye shall at all turn from following me, there it is, there it is. That's what the author said.
Yeah, right.
But if you shall turn at all from following me, you or your children, and will not keep my commandments and my statutes, which I have set before you, but go and serve other gods and worship them, then will I cut off Israel. Yeah. I just thought about being cut off. When you turn from God, you can be cut off of your miracles, your healings. When I first came here, I received a miracle for my man, and I got a new heart. And I don't even feel the same way I used to. I used to be angry, upset at everybody, blaming people for everything that was going on in my life, which I had control of, but I just blamed it on them because I thought it was their fault. I didn't know any better because I didn't know God. And Solomon had everything. God even gave him things he didn't ask for because he looked to God's heart, and he wanted everything. He wanted to please God. And that's what I want to do. I want to please God. But once you turn away from him, which is compromising with your family, letting people talk against your ministry that you said that you love, and you stop paying your tax, you stop doing all these things that you once did for God, and God granted you that mercy and that grace, and he granted you a job to pay your bills, to be able to take care of you and your family, and you just turn away from him, all of a sudden, you just lose everything. And I just want to let you know that you don't want to lose nothing that God gave you, because it's so great to have God. It's so great to know the real God. It's so great to know that you can depend on him. You can call him for anything that you need. I just really thank God for all that he has.
That's wonderful. I was thinking about that, too. Because serving other gods don't necessarily mean
And that was one of Solomon's problems. He said he loved the Lord, but he let those strange wives.
Yep. So that don't necessarily mean, though, that you're talking about idol gods or statues. No, anything that you put before God, anything that you do ahead of God, going ahead of him and not going, waiting for his counsel, not waiting on him. That's one thing that we have trouble with, is going ahead of God. And always saying that something is for us, but it really isn't. It's not what God wants us to have. So that's the thing I was thinking about, what Charlotte was sharing about Solomon and his strange wives. All I could think about was, he was warned. And he turned.
And God does warn us. The Bible clearly says, first warning and then destruction. I know you got something to say, Sharon.
I'm sorry, I'm stuck on my head. I am so much loving this, because also bringing us back to your mind how great God has been. Because I just to piggyback off Ministry Vaughn, which is my mommy, and Reverend Thomas, and Charlotte, and me, and just piggyback on every comment you guys made, if you turn, and also just the idol gods and getting ahead of God. I thought about many years when I had got ahead of God, and I turned away from the Lord, I almost lost my mind. And I'm thinking,
actually, you did have a nervous breakdown, Thomas.
And it's something to sit here today, I'm able to reason. There was a time I couldn't even reason. I couldn't pray because I turned away from God and I blamed him. I went ahead of the Lord and I got into trouble, but I blamed him for it. Mm-hmm. I blamed God for something that I did and he didn't have no part of. He was trying to help me. He put warning signs in my way, like Reverend Thomas said so wonderfully. First warning, then destruction. But destruction comes when I didn't listen. And it had nothing to do with God. And I think about that many years ago, God, how great God is, because he could have let me lose my man, not bring my man back. But he knew at that time that I was ignorant and I didn't know any better, but a lesson had to be learned from me. And I lost my man. I mean, my mother can vouch for me. I mean, I couldn't pray. I didn't want to eat. I didn't want to even bathe myself. How embarrassing to say that. But I can say that because I'm free today.
Yes,
and
it's only so wonderful. Does is a Fast for Christ book club. I know, right? I am really enjoying this. I hope you will continue to be with us. We have Check in the Mail, and we
have our skits. Did you enjoy My Name Is Gossip? That was so great. But we want to share one more thing with you before we leave today, and it's on page number 18. Sharon and Minister Yvonne alluded to it briefly, but some strange wives. It says here on page 18 that Solomon loved his many strange wives. But King Solomon loved many strange women of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go in to them, neither shall they come in unto you. For surely, they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clave unto these in love.
Wow.
What y'all think about that? I love her.
Oh,
chapter one of my favorite books. Have you ever loved somebody who didn't love you back? Neighbor, I hope you would help to sponsor this ministry at Pastor Christ Ministries. And we are doing so many things here at our church, and you're going to see our broadcast times, and you're going to see our address and our service times. And I want to invite you to stop on by the church sometimes. And if you don't have an opportunity, just watch us here on WJYS. Why don't you partner with us? Become a partner with us. And you know, we are just coming back on WJYS after being off of TV for nearly 2 years. And being on TV is expensive, and we want you to partner with us. If we have said anything that's of a benefit to you, you should help us sponsor this great ministry that we may continue these great works that we're doing now. Why don't you send your contribution to A Passion for Christ Ministries right here at P.O. Box 198-525, right here in Chicago, Illinois. Well, neighbor, that's it for our book club today. I hope you were blessed today. God bless you, and I'll see you next time. So long.